Time for another board game review, and this time we have the game The Voyages of Marco Polo. This was sent to me by Z-Man Games and is designed by Danielle Teschini and Simone Luciani. In Marco Polo, players embody one of the many people who worked with and around Marco Polo during his travels. They start in Venice, but the choices each player makes will affect the journey upon which they embark. These decisions must be carefully considered. Will you go directly to Beijing, or would you prefer to follow the lavish route outside Sumatra? In addition to these strategic options, which change from game to game, players must also consider which contracts are worthwhile, as well as where and when other players are likely to get in their way. Whether you play as the monk William of Rubruck, as a merchant from Tabriz, or even Kublai Khan himself, the game is always exciting and challenging. Who will you be this time? We show you how to play. So, in this game, players play as associates of Marco Polo, who traveled with him and in the surrounding areas. Each player tries to collect points by completing contracts and visiting as many lucrative cities as possible. Completed contracts provide more than just victory points, they also offer discounts and the ability to use privileges in the cities you visit. On top of that, they let you reach goals for the end of the game. At the end of the game, the winner is the player with the most victory points. Play is in clockwise order, each player acting in turn. You roll your dice and use them to occupy action spaces on the board. You then keep taking turns until all the dice have been used, and at that point the round ends and the game lasts a total of 5 rounds. After that, there's a short final scoring. But yeah, let's kind of get into a game turn. So on your turn, you roll your dice. A turn in this game means choosing at least one dice from your player board and placing it onto the action space of your choice. You can add your die to an unoccupied brown or blue action space, or to an already occupied blue action space, and then you immediately perform the action. So if you look here, these tell you the number of dice required, and also there's different color action spaces, which I'll get into. There are also optional bonus actions on your player aid card that each player has, and these can be always freely chosen either before or after your regular action. This is up to you on whether you want to use these. Now, as long as you have dice left, you must always choose and perform exactly one action. Once you're out of dice, you pass automatically and have no more turns for the round. So before we get into what the action spaces do, let's just talk about general rules. You can only use your own dice, not dice of any other player. You must use as many dice as shown on the action space, so this one would require 3. You can place your dice on unoccupied brown or blue spaces, or occupied blue spaces. If you want to use an occupied blue action space, like let's say player 1 is here, you have to pay coins to use this action if it's blocked. If a brown action space is occupied though, you can't use it. Also, each player color can only be used once on each action space. We'll go into that a little bit later. The die value themselves will indicate how many times you can do an action or how much the action gets you. The exception is this one. This one just gives you 5 coins. And if you're allowed to perform an action out multiple times or get more, you can always choose to do it fewer times or get less. But you always have to do the action at least once. And remember, the general rule of flow for actions is place your dice, pay coins if you need to, do the action. So first off, we got the take the 5 coins space. In this case, the die value doesn't matter. You just put one die here. Get 5 coins. Another action you can do is the Grand Bazaar. You need these goods if you want to complete your contracts in the game. So what you do is you place your dice on a specific action space. Like let's say I put these two here. Or I'll say, let's say these two. You determine how many goods you receive. And then you take the goods and put them on your player board. So if I put these two dice here, I always look at the lowest number die. And that tells me what kind of goods I get. Okay, so I would take 3 silk. And I'm gonna put them on my player board. Another thing you can claim is camels. You'll need these to complete certain contracts or move along certain routes or adjust die results and claiming black dice. You receive them the same way. So if I place this red die here for this player, I could receive 4 camels. Here's another way to get goods, the Khan's Favor. If you place a die on the Khan's Favor space, you can take exactly 1 good of your choice and 2 camels. Adding them to your warehouse. The first player to do so puts their die on the leftmost space. The next player who wishes to use it must place a die on the next space over, and it has to be equal to or greater to this die. So let's say the next player puts a 5 here. Then the next one would have to be 5 or 6, and so forth. And remember, each player color can only occupy an action space 1 at a time, so a yellow player and green player could not use this space again. Another action you can do is take a contract. These contracts are things where you pay certain goods and get rewards, but you need these in order to get them. You place a die on this space. The value of the dice determines what you can choose from. So if red player puts a 4 here, then they could choose from these contracts. You take one or two of them and you place them on your player board in the contract slots. And you get a little bonus if you take one from the 5 or 6 slot. For the 5 slot, you can take a coin or a camel. And for the 6 slot, you can take 2 coins or 2 camels. Once contracts are taken, you immediately slide anything down to the left and fill the gaps. If all contract spaces are empty at the beginning of your turn, you just draw 2 contacts from the special contacts pile, or contract, sorry, and place them between 1 and 2. There's only room on your board for 2 contracts, so when you take new contracts, you must have room for them or need to make room. If you don't have enough space, you'll have to discard your older contracts, adding them to the bottom of the special contract pile. Another action you can do is traveling. If you place dice here, you can move your little figure on the board around the different spaces. First off, you place your die. The value of the lowest die determines how many spaces you can move. Each travel action shows the cost for movement. That means you always pay for your movement. You only pay for the spaces you actually moved. So if I move one space, I'll have to pay 3 coins, 2, 7, and so on. Sometimes routes will have additional costs. Like if you look here, you need to pay 2 extra camels to move along there. So you gotta make sure you are aware of what costs you have to pay when you're moving around. Once you've paid your cost, you may then move your figure however many spaces. Now, if your action ends in a large city, you have to place a trading post here. If you look at your board here, you have a certain number of trading posts. You place your trading post here, and from this turn on, you can use this die action on your future turns. And these cards are randomly shuffled and determined at the beginning of each game, so each game is different. This particular action space would let you spend 2 camels to get 2 coins and 1 victory point. If you end your turn in a small city, you also have to put a trading post here. And what this indicates is that you'll receive the indicated bonus. That's what this exclamation point means at the start of each subsequent round. This is a nice bonus of 1 camel and 3 coins at the beginning of each future round, which is pretty nice. As you place your trading post, you start upper left, down, like this, as you slowly remove these. Because once you remove your 8th post, you'll get 5 victory points on your score track. And once you place your 9th, you'll get 10 victory points. If you end your movement in Beijing, you place a trading post on the highest valued unoccupied space, because that means you got there first. That would give you 10 points. Those are scored at the end of the game. Moving back and forth is allowed. You can pass through or end your movement on the same location multiple times, but you may never have more than one trading post in any large or small city. The travel action will also determine the start player for the next round, which I'll get into later.
Oops, no I didn't. Okay, so let's go into that. Whoever uses the travel action last that round gets to start the next round. Okay, cool, let's keep going.
You may also notice in each city there are these little half dome things. If you're the first player to reach a city, you get the bonus. This would give you 2 camels. That one would give you 5 coins. You just take this from the board and remove it and get the reward. Now, if you've placed all your trading posts on the board, the next time you must place one, you move an existing trading post from one location to the other. Now, I mentioned before the city actions you can do if you have a trading post. So let's look at some other examples on the board. Like here, if you pay 2 camels, you can move your figure 1 space. Now, you still have to pay additional costs like camels, but otherwise it's a free movement. A lot of these are pretty straightforward, like, oh yeah, you pay this, you get this. This lets you actually exchange victory points and coins, or coins for victory points. There's also ways to get, you know, silk or whatever, depends on what you place here for your die. Or if you have one like this, this counts how many trading posts you've placed on the board, but it's limited by the dice you place here. So let's say I put a 3 here, and I had 4 outposts, I would still only get to get 3 of them scored, or 6 coins, because you get 2 coins for each you've completed. And if you'll notice, since these are brown spaces, if once somebody occupies an action space for a city, no one else can use it for that round. Now let's go over these bonus actions. You can always do these before or after an action. First thing you can do is complete a contract. If you have enough goods for a contract, you would pay them to the supply, then you receive the rewards, and you put this completed contract in your little drawer here. Another action you can always do is place a die on this money bag and take 3 coins, regardless of the value.
Another action you can do is return one camel to the supply and re-roll one of your die. If you send two camels to the supply, you can adjust your die value by up or down by one, so a two can be three or a one. And finally, if you return three camels to the supply, you can take an extra bonus black die, roll it, oh, that's a bad roll, and add it to your player board and use it for that round. You only take one of those per turn, though. Now, I mentioned before that brown spaces cannot be used if they're occupied, but blue spaces you can use if they're occupied, but you have to pay a fee. So let's say green player wanted to use this double space, they would look at the lowest value die that they're gonna use, and they have to pay that many coins. So this green player would have to spend two coins, and then they could use this action. When you do that, you can just stack the dice on top of there to see the order of who last chose the action. Now, what's special about the black die and also the white die if you have that character is you can use these as any player color. So this actually would not break the rule of you using this same action space again, because it's technically a different color. You can also combine your black die with your regular die for specific actions. Now, they do have a compensation rule for low die rolls. Let's say you get a really shitty roll like this, and your total is less than 15, you receive compensation, actually, in the form of coins or camels. You can take one coin or one camel for each point of difference. So this adds up to 11, so you can receive up to 4 of coins and or camels. Now you play 5 rounds, and after 5 rounds you do your final scoring. Now one thing I didn't mention is that each player actually gets 2 secret goal cards that only they know about. And what these goal cards are they want you to put specific trading posts in specific cities. So this card, if you put one in Moscow and Kashgar, you would get 7 points at the end. And if you put one in Samarkanda and Jan, you would get 4 points. Now what this table means at the bottom is since you have 4 different cities, you can also score bonus points for how many different of cities you accomplish at the end. You would get up to 10 points extra. If you happen to have the same city on both cards, that only counts as 3 cities for the scoring table here, because it's technically much easier. You also get a victory point for every 10 coins you have left, and if you have a trading post in Beijing, which is technically the, like, end goal, you'll get the points depending on how you placed on that. And if you have a trading post in Beijing, you score 1 victory point for every 2 goods you have. But if you don't have one in Beijing, you get nothing for those extra goods. And remember, camels are not goods. Also, whoever has the most completed contracts in your contract delivery pile will receive 7 bonus points at the end. If there's a tie, winner with the most camels. So those are the actions of the game. You know, you're moving around, placing your outposts and getting bonuses and other actions. And you're just trying to get as many victory points and completing your goals as you can. But one thing I did not mention is that you also all have a character power. Let's get into these. Rashid ad-Din Sinan, you don't roll your dice at the beginning of each round. So whenever you choose an action, you get to choose the die you use. However, you cannot receive compensation, which is the less than 15 you get bonuses roll. And of course, you must still pay if you want to use an occupied action space, and pay additional costs when traveling through routes. Matteo Polo receives an extra white die that they get to roll at the beginning of each round, and also at the beginning of each round, they get the topmost contract in the special pile, so they're always getting contracts even without going to the contract action space. Mercator X Tabriz actually has 3 different versions depending on how many players you have, but the basic gist of his is that whenever another player goes to the bazaar, you get one of the goods that they choose. This also counts for camels, so he's just like leeching onto other people's purchases. Kublai Khan starts in Beijing, meaning they get the 10 victory point space immediately, and they get to start from there instead, meaning they get to start over here and have less competition on this side. Johannes Caprini can move from one oasis on the map to another during movement. So if he goes here, he could go here, which is pretty nuts. You also receive 3 coins at the start of each round. Burke Khan does not have to pay for occupied action spaces. However, this does not allow you to use occupied city cards, but still, pretty nice bonus. Niccolo and Marco Polo, you get an extra figure on the board, so you can move both of those guys around. and you get a camo at the start of each round. However, you still have to pay all travel and additional costs before moving both figures. And finally, William of Rubruck receives 2 black trading posts at the start of the game. You add these to your other trading posts. If you can place all 11 of them, you'll score an extra 10 victory points at the end. He also has the great bonus of he can place trading posts in any city that he moves through. Usually you have to end your travel to place a trading post, but this guy can just zip on through and just place them. Other than that, that's pretty much it. You just zip around placing your trading posts and unlocking new actions, trying to race to get bonuses and get to Beijing if you want to get those extra points. But it's all about those points, baby.
So I'm gonna be honest, this is a game where the theme of it, I was like, oh boy, this looks like a real drag. Marco Polo, who gives a shit? But, gotta say, pretty clever game. The dice placement for actions is clever. I like that certain actions require more dice, and if you play with 4 players, you are constantly getting in each other's ways for actions, because it's like a very limited number of actions on the board. Also in this game, money and resources are always tight. You never feel like you have enough in this game, and the order of actions is extremely important. So if you like those very kind of thinky games, you'll enjoy this. The dice are also used in a smart way. Like, I've played a lot of dice placement sort of board games, but I like that in this, instead of focusing on specific numbers, most action spaces can be used by any dice. The numbers themselves just tell you how much of something you get or how many times you can do it. So that kind of mitigates the luck factor. Instead of like, oh, I didn't roll a 5, I needed exactly a 5 to do that. It's like, no, you can roll whatever you want. You'll just get less rewards depending on what you place. The whole completing contracts is always satisfying. I love reaping the rewards of that, getting the exact goods you need. The traveling can be really expensive and really tough. This game really forces you to think about where you want to go. It's like a giant race, but it's filled with expensive toll gates along the way. I do like the bonus system where if you enter a large city, you get that bonus first. That's a nice incentive to travel quickly. I will say the hidden goal cards you get at the beginning can feel a little too random. There is an expert mode that the game lets with a variant rule set where you can actually let each player choose 2 from 4, which I think is a much better idea. Otherwise, the cards are kind of out of your control. It feels very Ticket to Ride in that way. Also, super tiny nitpick, but I think I'm legit in this. I didn't mention this in the rules explanation, but the 3 item counters are just slightly bigger than the regular counters. This is absolute bullshit. There is no way at a glance to tell for sure if this is a 3-1 or a 1-1. These are way too similar. Don't make your 3 item counters like this. Don't do that. Super nitpick aside, the character powers are all very distinct and they feel equally balanced because all of them feel very powerful. Like, clearly a lot of them kind of break the rules of the game for each player, and that's fun. That's always fun to be like, ooh, I don't have to roll my dice, or ooh, I can start here. Like, it gives you a fun sort of like unique advantage that doesn't feel too crazy because everyone's got a crazy thing. Overall, this is a solid dice placement game, but it is pretty tough in the resource management. If you don't like games that are kind of punishing, especially if you like can't get the actions you need, or you feel like I never have enough, you may not like this game because it is very tough in that regard. Because you can use your multiple dice in different ways, it forces you to think about your actions very carefully, which is, for me, a good thing. I like the strategy of it, but for some people it might be overwhelming. And like I said before, the theme is a little dry. Like Marco Polo, I don't care at all. But if you're looking for a well-designed dice placement, resource management, contract-fulfilling, like, or goal-fulfilling game, this one's definitely worth checking out. Just get past that boring-ass cover, and underneath there's a pretty fun, challenging dice placement resource game here. I recommend it.